Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Bridal Suite by Rochelle Alers. Narrated by Susan Spain. A quote from Proverbs, chapter 22, verse 6. Start children off on the way they should go, and even when they are old, they will not turn from it. Chapter 1. Miss Santiago, Miss Washington is waiting inside for you. Nydia opened her eyes. She hadn't realized she'd fallen asleep for the second time that morning. The text message from a car service indicated a 5 a.m. pickup in front of her parents' West Harlem brownstone. The drive to the Westchester Regional Airport was accomplished quickly, and a sleek private jet was on a runway awaiting her arrival. She was one of seven passengers on the aircraft, scheduled for several stops, with San Diego, California as the final destination. Once they were airborne, members of the flight crew served a sumptuous breakfast prepared by an onboard chef. And as soon as the cabin lights were dimmed, she reclined her seat and slept until the attendant woke her minutes before noon to inform her they were approaching the Louis Armstrong New Orleans International Airport. Once the jet landed, she was whisked through the baggage claim and found a car service driver awaiting her arrival. She got into the comfortable sedan and promptly fell asleep again. When they arrived, the chauffeur opened the rear door, and she placed her hand on the man's palm as he assisted her out of the vehicle. "Thank you." Tilting her head, she sniffed the hot, humid air and smiled. There was something about the way New Orleans smelled Nydia found intoxicating. The hotel's bellhop rushed over to the town car and removed her bags from the trunk. Jasmine's fiancé had made the arrangements for her to stay at the boutique hotel where Cameron rented a suite. When she'd asked her friend why her fiancé lived at a hotel, Jasmine had revealed his living arrangements were temporary. He had recently purchased a three-story Victorian converted warehouse with a rear courtyard and a garage with enough space for three vehicles. She said they planned to use the first floor for entertaining family, friends, and clients, and the two upper floors for their personal use. Nydia took a step and bit down on her lower lip to stifle a gasp when she felt a slight twinge in the incision from a recent surgical procedure. It was a reminder that it had only been 3 days since she was medically cleared to travel. She'd ignored what had become chronic pain in her right side for several weeks until it had become so debilitating that she was forced to call her father and plead with him to take her to the emergency room. 45 minutes after their arrival, she was wheeled into the operating room for the removal of a ruptured appendix. The surgery could not have come at a worse time because she'd been scheduled to fly down to New Orleans for the wedding. This was her third trip to the Big Easy in 13 months. The first was last July when she, Jasmine Washington, Tanya Martin, and Samara, Tanya's daughter, drove from New York to visit their former coworker, Hannah DuPont Lowell. So many things had happened to Nydia and her friends since they were downsized from an international Wall Street private investment firm. Nydia and 24 other employees could have never imagined when they walked into Wakefield Hamilton on a warm, sunny morning in May that it was to become their last day of employment. The company had merged with another institution, and although they were given generous severance packages, none were offered the option of staying and commuting to Trenton, New Jersey. She, Tanya, and Jasmine had returned to New Orleans in October as bridal attendants for Hannah's wedding to her former high school classmate, St. John McNair. And Nydia's third trip would have been this past June to witness Tanya's wedding to St. John's cousin, Gage Toussaint, if she hadn't been hospitalized. She was back again to stand as maid of honor for Jasmine's wedding to Cameron Singleton. A wry smile parted her lips. She didn't know what it was about the Crescent City, but it was obvious her friends had been seduced by the food, music, and the men. Gathering her purse, Nydia slowly followed the bellhop into the Louis LaSalle. The automatic doors opened, and the scene unfolding before her eyes made her feel as if she had stepped back in time. Marble floors, a trio of massive crystal chandeliers, overstuffed brocade-covered chairs and sofas welcomed one to linger a while. Gilt-framed paintings of men and women dressed in their finery from a bygone era hung from the ornately papered walls. An enormous bouquet of fresh flowers overflowing a hand-painted glazed vase set on a large round mahogany table was the lobby's focal point. Bienvenido de nuevo a la Gran Facile. Nydia turned and smiled. She hadn't noticed Jasmine's approach. The affection she felt for her friend was reflected in her smile as she extended her arms and hugged Jasmine. She was still attempting to wrap her head around the news that her former co-worker was pregnant and planning to marry the father of her unborn baby in 2 weeks. I can't believe you're welcoming me back as if you've lived here for years instead of a few months, Nydia teased. Jasmine returned her smile. I never thought I'd ever move from the Big Apple, but now that I live here, I've come to love the Big Easy. Easing back, she studied Jasmine's face. The interior decorator turned human resource specialist's longer, coal-black wavy hair framed a face that was noticeably fuller than when they were last together. The genes she had inherited from her African-American father and Filipino mother had blended with a gold-brown complexion, slightly slanting eyes, a pert nose, and lush mouth. Nydia could see why Cameron hadn't been able to pull his gaze away from Jasmine at Hannah's wedding reception. You're actually glowing. Don't you mean growing? Please, Jazz, Nydia drawled. You don't look pregnant. Her friend had just completed her first trimester. It's the dress. I'm already losing my waistline. Jasmine looped an arm through Nydia's. Come with me, I'll take you to your room. She signaled for the bellhop with Nydia's bags to follow her. Oh, I forgot to ask. How are you feeling? The incision is still a little tender, but other than that, I'm good. Good enough to dance salsa at my wedding? Nydia met Jasmine's dark eyes. Both had agreed how much they enjoyed dancing to live Latin music. You hired a band? A mysterious smile touched the corners of Jasmine's mouth. I couldn't get one on such short notice, so I had the DJ compile a playlist with some popular dance numbers. They rode the elevator to the fourth floor in silence. Jasmine had confided to Nydia that only Hannah, Tanya, and Cameron's family knew she was going to marry him the afternoon following his parents' 50th wedding anniversary banquet. However, someone had leaked that Cameron was engaged but failed to identify the woman who was to become Mrs. Cameron Averill Singleton. Once Belinda Singleton confirmed the rumor her son was indeed planning to marry, shockwaves reverberated throughout the city. Because at the age of 48, the extremely attractive wealth manager had earned the reputation as a serial dater. And whenever someone saw Cameron with Jasmine and questioned their connection, his reply was he'd commissioned her to decorate his new home. Jasmine swiped a key card, opened the door, and stood aside as the bellhop pushed the dolly with Nydia's luggage into the suite. Her friend waited until he'd placed the Pullman on a luggage rack and two carry-on bags on the floor in front of the bedroom closet, and then reached into the large patch pocket of her sundress and surreptitiously handed him a tip. The young man nodded. Thank you, Miss Washington. Once the young man left, Nydia walked into the suite, her hazel eyes noticeably widening when she surveyed the space where she would spend the next month. It was now the first week in August, and she planned to return to New York following the Labor Day weekend. The contemporary pale gray and white seating grouping in the living room complemented the glass-topped dining room table with four alternating gray and white upholstered chairs set on a geometric black, white, and gray area rug. Gunmetal gray, floor-to-ceiling silk drapes were pulled back to allow brilliant sunlight to flood the open floor plan that included a galley kitchen with stainless steel appliances. She opened the refrigerator to find small individual containers with tuna, chicken, shrimp, and caprese salads. There was also a larger container filled with mixed greens. A shelf was filled with bottled water, juice, and small jars of labeled salad dressings. I didn't know what you wanted to eat for lunch, so I decided to order a little something from the kitchen to tide you over until we have dinner with Tanya and Hannah tonight, Jasmine said as Nydia closed the refrigerator door. She smiled at her friend. You're the best. Are we going out to eat? Jasmine shook her head. Not tonight. I reserved one of the smaller private dining rooms here at the hotel. The owner just hired a new chef to oversee the kitchen, and he's quite talented. Is he better than Tanya's in-laws? Jasmine shook her head again. Not quite. There's something about the food from Chez Toussaint's that's indescribable. That's why I told Cameron I wanted Eustace engaged to cater our wedding. You have to remember that Tanya's no slouch when it comes to throwing down in the kitchen, Nydia reminded Jasmine. She turned and made her way down a narrow hallway, peering into a half bath before entering the bedroom that also included an ensuite spa bath. Yards of diaphanous white shears draped a California King mahogany four-poster bed, and wall-to-wall, floor-to-ceiling windows. A seating area with a brocade cream-colored chaise, a small mahogany round table with two pull-up chairs, and a bookcase filled with hardcover and paperback books and magazines, provided a space to sit and while away the hours. The heavy, dark furniture was the perfect contrast to the off-white furnishings. Coño, mija, Nydia drawled. You really hooked me up. It's the least I could do for my una princesa puertorriqueña. Nydia couldn't stop laughing. She'd occasionally referred to herself as a Puerto Rican princess. Other than family members, Jasmine was the only one with whom she occasionally spoke Spanish. Her friend had learned the language from her mother and Tagalog from her grandparents whenever she'd visited the Philippines. Jasmine followed Nydia into the living room and sat on the love seat, while Nydia sat on the sofa. I knew you'd like the bridal suite. Nydia sobered and gave Jasmine an incredulous stare. You put me in the bridal suite? Yes, it's one of the nicest ones in the hotel. If you're going to live here for a month, then you should have the best amenities. Other than the connecting suite where Cameron and I stay, all of the others only have minibars and microwaves. And it's the least I could do for my maid of honor. And if you hadn't strong-armed me into going out with Cameron, I never would have been given the chance to become a romance novel heroine and experience a happily ever after. I didn't strong-arm you, Jazz. I said you had nothing to lose by having one dinner date with the man. Jasmine patted her belly over the sundress. And look what it got me. It got you what you've always wanted, a baby and a husband who doesn't need your money. Cameron is nothing like that slug you married, who not only parked his shoes under another woman's bed and got her pregnant, but subsequently snipped his cheating-ass dick and denied you a child. And on top of that, the slimeball tried to pimp you out of a business you'd shed blood, sweat, and tears to make a success. Fast forward a few years and you meet Cameron Singleton, who'd professed he didn't want to marry or father children, and boom. He takes one look at Miss Jasmine Washington and folds up like an accordion. She pressed her first two fingers to her lips and then pantomimed dropping a mic. Santiago out. Jasmine laughed until her sides hurt. You know you missed your calling. You should have become a stand-up comedian instead of an accountant. Nydia shook her head and a mane of loose, dark brown curls moved around her small, round face as if taking on a life of their own. I'd never be able to come up with enough jokes to earn a living, and I'm not about to recreate stories about some of my crazy family members or people I grew up with, because that would be dangerous to my health. They'd know immediately who I was talking about. Some of the dudes in my old neighborhood have street names like Loco Carlos or Diablo Flacito, and are walking billboards of ink advertising drugs, murder, and prison. Jasmine stopped laughing. Talk about earning a living. Have you given any further thought about investing in Hannah's DuPont Inn? You know she's expecting you to be her CFO. Nydia had become the last holdout when it came to investing in Hannah's new project to turn her ancestral home into an inn. Although Nydia found the offer quite tempting, she still wasn't certain whether she wanted to relocate. Her family was in New York, and the opportunity to secure a position with a company looking for a certified public accountant with a salary commensurate with her education and experience had kept her from committing to becoming an innkeeper. I have thought about it. It is very enticing. If that's the case, then what's stopping you, chica? And if you tell me you're seeing Danny again, I'm going to go, as you say, apeshit. A slight frown marred Nydia's youthful-looking features. She'd recently celebrated her 33rd birthday, yet she was still mistaken for a college co-ed and carded whenever she ordered alcohol. And with her recent weight loss of more than 10 pounds her petite frame could ill afford to lose, she appeared even younger. I told you before, I'm done with Danny. You know I was angry with Wakefield Hamilton because they'd fired us without warning. But now that I look back, I know it's the best thing that ever happened to me. If not, I still would have been renting a furnished apartment in my nosy landlady's house and hoping, wishing, and praying for Danny to get his act together. Once Tanya told me I could sublet her apartment and I moved in, I was able to experience what it meant to be in complete control of my life for the first time since moving out on my own. Because I don't have someone clocking who's coming and going in and out of the apartment. And one of the many perks in living in the renovated building is the security. Closed circuit cameras are integrated within the intercom system, which allows me to see who's ringing my bell. So even if Danny does happen to find out where I live, I don't have to let him in. I know you're living out Tanya's renewal lease until next year, but what are you going to do once it expires? Are you going to take it over under your name? Nydia exhaled an audible breath. Jasmine was asking a question she'd asked herself over and over the closer it got to the lease's expiration date. Lately, I'm not sure. I know if I had a permanent position with a company, I would definitely consider it. I gave Tanya the entire year's rent in advance from my savings, and while I'm doing the books for several restaurateurs, I earn enough to cover nearly 3/4 of the monthly rent, which means with the new lease I'd have to dip into my savings to make up the difference and pay for utilities and buy groceries. Have you begun looking for something permanent? Jasmine asked. Not yet. I've decided to wait until after Labor Day to begin a job search. My brother's friend, who's an intelligence analyst for the FBI, has been urging me to apply to the Bureau as an accounting and finance special agent. Nydia knew she had shocked Jasmine with this disclosure when her jaw dropped. Why the FBI? Jasmine questioned. Because I have the qualifications. Bachelor's degree in forensic accounting, an MBA and CPA. What are the qualifications are they asking for? I'm within the age range and have more than 3 years professional experience. Of course, I'd have to pass a security clearance background check and a physical. Jasmine stared at the framed watercolor of a Venetian palazzo overlooking a canal with moored gondolas. You're an independent woman with options as to where you want to take your future. Nydia leaned forward. Why would you say it like that? Her dark brown eyes met a shimmering, clear brown pair, with glints of green and gold, and a complexion that reminded Jasmine of frothy mocha icing. All my life I've relied on men to take care of me. First there was my father, and then Gregory Carson, who was my first lover and mentor. Gregory was 30 years my senior, and he gave me what I needed to become a much sought-after successful interior decorator. I met Raymond Rios after Gregory died, and married him a year later. I probably still would be married to him if I hadn't discovered he'd cheated on me. Now, 3 years later, it's Cameron Singleton. What's wrong with that, Jazz? So many women never experience a man's protection, and after what you had to go through with Raymond, you've been given a second chance at love. Her eyelids fluttered. I know, but I wanted to wait until after giving birth to marry Cameron. A rush of color suffused Nydia's complexion, and she clenched her teeth. Why? So you can become a baby mama? Do you have any idea how many women would love to change places with you? I know girls who've had wonderful relationships with their boyfriends until they mention the B word. And then their men act as if she's come down with bubonic plague. Halfway through our second year, my college roommate told me her boyfriend wanted her to have an abortion over the winter break because he claimed he couldn't afford to take care of another child. That's when she found out that he had two other kids and both his baby mamas had taken him to court for child support. Jasmine smothered a gasp. Did she have the abortion? Nydia nodded. It was either get rid of the baby or lose the man. A month after she had the procedure, he broke up with her. Talk about a hot mess. She had an emotional breakdown and dropped out of school. When I called her parents home, they told me she'd moved to Arizona to live with her older sister. Now back to you, Miss soon-to-be Mrs. Cameron Singleton. You probably think Cameron wants to marry you because you're carrying his child, but didn't you tell me he's admitted to being in love with you? He has, and I'm in love with him. Then what's the problem? Has he said anything about you going into business with Hannah? No. He couldn't because I'd given Hannah my word, and we'd finalized our business agreement even before I realized I was pregnant. The man has allowed you to be an independent woman and control your life. Something his father hadn't permitted his mother. So why are you being a drama queen? I didn't come down here during the hottest month of the freaking year to listen to you talk about marrying Cameron after you push out his baby. I love you like a sister, but so help me, Jazz, I will go apeshit and show my natural ass and end up on the local news if you don't go through with this wedding. You wouldn't, Jasmine whispered. Girl, please, Nydia drawled. There's a crazy side to Nydia Stephanie Santiago you don't ever want to see. She snapped her fingers. I can bring the funk with the best of them. I didn't say anything about not marrying Cameron. I was just saying. Don't say anything else, Jasmine, Nydia interrupted. Either it's hormones or premarital jitters, but I'm going to help you get through this. I remember my sister-in-law's mood swings when she was pregnant with her first child. She drove my brother crazy when she began calling him Nelson rather than Luis, which happens to be his middle name. We later discovered one of her exes was named Luis, and she didn't want to relive her past, so to humor her, we all started calling him Nelson. What did he say to that? Jasmine asked. My brother worships his wife, so she can do or say no wrong. Personally, I think he goes along with her just to keep the peace. Being a cop is stressful enough without coming home to bitching and moaning. His motto is, happy wife, happy life. Jasmine noticed Nydia's eyelids drooping as she attempted to stay awake. She pushed to her feet, reached into the pocket of her dress, and placed two key cards on the coffee table. I'm sitting here running off at the mouth when you need to rest after getting up before dawn. I'm going upstairs to my suite to take a nap before we get together later for dinner. I'll meet you in the lobby at 7. Nydia stood. Will Cameron be joining us? I'm not sure. He scheduled an early dinner meeting with a client, and I'm not certain how long it'll last. Tell him I really appreciate his taking care of my travel arrangements. She nodded, smiling. You can tell him yourself when you see him. Turning, she walked to the door, opened it, and then closed it behind her. She'd wanted to tell Nydia that she was experiencing premarital jitters, that she'd committed to marrying a stranger, a man who had gotten her pregnant the first time they'd made love, despite using protection. Jasmine had vacillated whether she wanted to marry before or after the birth of her child because she wanted Cameron to want her for his wife and not because she was carrying a singleton. Openly admitting to Nydia that he loved her had helped her to acknowledge she'd made the right decision to marry the father of her unborn child at this time. Nydia said she loved her like a sister, and it was the same with her when it came to the gifted young accountant who'd graduated college with honors and passed the CPA exam on her first attempt. She could always count on her friend not to sugarcoat what she needed to hear. Not only had she asked Nydia to be her maid of honor, but she also planned to ask her to become godmother to her son or daughter. Chapter 2. Nydia punched the elevator button for the lobby. She'd put off taking a nap until after she'd eaten the caprese, chicken salad, and mixed greens with a balsamic dressing. She then set the alarm on her cell phone to wake her at 5 o'clock, which gave her time to unpack and take a bath. Relaxing in the garden tub and luxuriating in the feel of pulsing jets of water on her body for the next half hour had revived her to where she was ready to reconnect with her friends and enjoy the warm camaraderie they'd developed over the past year. At 33, she was the youngest of the quartet, and there was a 20-plus-year age difference between her, Tanya, and Hannah. However, at no time had she ever thought of them as mother figures. To her, they were her older sisters. Nydia still marveled that she was able to hold her own when interacting with them, perhaps because she tended to say exactly what came to mind. Jasmine accused her of having no filter, but the truth was, she detested duplicitous people. She preferred folks to speak their mind, even if she didn't agree with them. The elevator stopped at the lobby. The doors opened, and as soon as she exited the car, she saw Tanya, Hannah, and Jasmine standing together near the table with the massive bouquet. Tanya spied her first and approached Nydia. It was apparent marriage had more than agreed with the professional chef. A light blue sleeveless linen sheath dress flattered Tanya's toned body, while her short, gray-flecked hair flattered a flawless dark complexion, radiating good health. Twin dimples dotted her cheeks when she smiled. "Welcome back, sweetie." Nydia hugged Tanya. "I'm sorry I missed seeing you marry your muy sexy papi." Throwing back her head, Tanya laughed. "When I told Gage you were coming down, he said he couldn't wait to meet you." Nydia had caught a glimpse of the talented musician for the first time when Hannah had taken them to a jazz club during their initial visit to the city. And she doubted that she was the only woman in the place transfixed by the handsome trumpet player's Creole, Cajun, and African ancestry. Not only was he a gifted musician, but he was also a skilled Parisian-trained chef. Tanya and Gage Toussaint had begun a whirlwind romance once she became an apprentice at his family's local restaurant, Chez Toussaint's, and were married 8 months later. Nydia looped her arm through Tanya's. "I'm planning to be here for a month, that is if the heat doesn't get to me like it did last summer." She, Jasmine, and Tanya had cut their 2 week stay short because of record temperatures and humidity. Tanya shook her head. "After moving down here, I realized I'd rather put up with the heat than the cold and snow." Hannah joined them. The tall blonde had put on a little weight since she'd married St. John, and Nydia had to acknowledge she looked wonderful. "Welcome back," she drawled, smiling. Nydia's lids fluttered as she forced back the tears filling her eyes. She hugged Hannah, the recognizable scent of Chanel No. 5 wafting to her nose. Everyone was welcoming her back as if she'd left home. She hadn't spent as much time in New Orleans as Tanya or Jasmine, yet there was something about the city that beckoned her to come and stay. It wasn't called the Big Easy for nothing, because she always felt completely relaxed whenever she came for a visit. "I'm glad to be back. And you're looking good, Mrs. McNair." Hannah was dressed entirely in white. Cropped slacks, a man-tailored shirt, and ballet-type flats. Her silver-streaked chin-length platinum hair was pulled off her face with a black-and-white pinstriped headband. An attractive blush darkened Hannah's fair complexion. "I feel wonderful. Should that be attributed to married life?" A fringe of pale lashes shadowed her cheekbones when she demurely lowered her eyes. "St. John's a wonderful husband." Her green eyes narrowed as she gave Nydia a long, penetrating stare. "You've lost a lot of weight." Nydia glanced down at the navy blue stretch capris she'd paired with a white tank top. "Not so much that I lost my booty." "Stop playing yourself," Jasmine said as she gave her a you-have-to-be-kidding-me look. "I didn't say anything earlier, but I wanted to tell you that you look a hot mess. And I'm going to make certain as long as you stay here, you'll have regular meals and gain some of that weight you lost." Nydia wanted to tell her friends that the pain before the appendectomy had been so debilitating, She'd almost stopped eating altogether. Once she was discharged from the hospital, she'd refused to take the prescribed opioid because she feared becoming addicted. So she endured the lingering discomfort as she waited for the incision to heal. However, in recent weeks, she'd regained 3 of the 14 pounds she'd lost. Tanya dropped an arm over Nydia's shoulders. I'm with Jasmine. Every day Mama's going to make a special plate for you and have someone bring it over to you. She felt a warm glow flow through her from her friend's concern about her. After she'd called Jasmine to tell her she was in the hospital, it was apparent she'd informed Hannah and Tanya because they'd called to check on her condition, while Jasmine had sent her an enormous basket filled with fruit, gourmet confectionaries, cheese, crackers, and nuts from all three. Speaking of eating, Jasmine said, it's time we head to the restaurant because everything has been set up for us. Are we going out? Tanya asked. Jasmine shook her head. No, I reserved one of the small private rooms here at the hotel, where we can eat at our leisure. I hope you all don't mind that I ordered for us, because the kitchen gets real busy around this time. I don't mind, Hannah said. You won't get an argument out of me, Nydia quipped. In addition to her friends, she missed the local dishes. She'd bought a cookbook featuring New Orleans cuisine and attempted to duplicate some of the recipes. It had taken several tries before she was able to perfect her favorite dish of red beans and rice. Even her mother raved about the kidney beans flavored with Cajun seasoning and spicy andouille sausage. Nydia entered the room with the others, smiling when she saw the round linen-covered table with seating for four set with china, silver, and crystal. Mouth-watering aromas wafted from a number of chafing dishes on the buffet table. There were also bottles of wine, water, soda, and a large bowl of ice. Jasmine picked up a plate. Don't be shy, ladies. Let's eat. You don't have to tell me twice, Nydia said, smiling. There were trays of fried chicken and catfish, red beans, rice, grilled shrimp, jambalaya, and jalapeno cornbread. I hope that's not all you're eating, Tanya said as she stared at Nydia's plate. No, as soon as I finish this, I'm going back for more. She'd selected shrimp, cornbread, and beans and rice. Once you're finished with Jasmine's wedding, I'd like you to teach me how to make pasteles. Nydia nodded. She did promise Tanya to show her how to make the tamales, filled with pork, chickpeas, yucca, olives, capers, and other spices. There was never a holiday or celebration in a Puerto Rican home where pasteles, pernil, and arroz con gandules weren't on the menu. Before Tanya moved to New Orleans, Nydia had taught her to make mofongo and alcapurria. No problem. Every year, she joined her mother, sister-in-law, and grandmother to make at least 100 pasteles for the Christmas holidays. Tanya's dimples deepened when she smiled. Thanks. I want to put them on the menu for my restaurant's Caribbean night. Nydia had no doubt that the restaurant Tanya and Gage planned to open once the inn was operational would become a much sought-after dining establishment. Tanya told her they would offer a few of Chez Toussaint's signature dishes and also a variety of small plates featuring international cuisine. It appeared as if her former co-workers were busy planning the next phase of their lives, while her future was still in limbo. And she knew she had to make a decision before the end of the year when it came time to renew the lease. Nydia had talked about her ex finding a real job, but now she found herself in the same situation. She had to stop dragging her feet and seriously think about securing permanent employment. Hannah had asked her to invest in her new business venture, which would give her 10% ownership in the inn. Even if she did decide to invest, she still would have some money from her severance payout, and if she did move to New Orleans, she would live rent-free in her own suite at the DuPont Inn. Whenever she thought about going into business with her former co-workers, the more appealing the notion had become. She didn't have children or a significant other to consider, and her extended family was only a couple of hours away by plane if she needed to fly up to New York. Nydia had a month to contemplate her next move, and once she returned home, she would know whether to accept or reject Hannah's offer to become an innkeeper. Hannah touched the corners of her mouth with her napkin. This hotel is where St. John and I reunited for our 40th high school reunion. Nydia met her eyes. It didn't take you long to become reacquainted before you married him. Hannah smiled and nodded. Remember, St. John and I were high school classmates, and when you get to my age, you don't want or need a long engagement. I knew even before we slept together the first time that I wanted to marry him. Tanya gave Hannah a side-eye glance. You didn't act like it when you came back to New York to close up your apartment. When we asked how things were going with St. John, you said they weren't, because he'd admitted to cheating on his ex-wife. And if we hadn't threatened to sleep with your man, you wouldn't have married him. Hannah lowered her eyes. I'll tell you all about that later. Nydia knew Hannah had aroused her curiosity along with the others. She'd known with a single glance that there was something going on between her former co-worker and the handsome college professor when he'd come to the DuPont house to take Hannah for their ballroom dance lesson. St. John was the total package, looks, brains, and breeding, and it was obvious the way he'd looked at Hannah that he was as enthralled with her as she was with him. How are the renovations going on the inn? Nydia asked Hannah, deftly changing the topic of conversation. The former corporate attorney rolled her eyes upward. Much slower than I'd anticipated. She gave Nydia a direct stare. The offer's still open if you want to become the CFO. Suddenly, Nydia felt as if Hannah had put her on the spot in front of the others. It was one thing to discuss the business arrangement one-on-one, but with Jasmine and Tanya already on board, she felt vulnerable. She knew her friends wanted her to relocate and join them in their new venture. I'm still thinking about it. Tanya patted Nydia's back. Don't think too long, sweetie. My mother used to say, opportunity is like a bald-headed man. You have to catch him as he's coming toward you. Once your hand slips off, it's gone. Amen to that, Jasmine and Hannah intoned at the same time. Nydia angled her head as she struggled not to laugh. Please don't tell me you rehearsed this in advance. Jasmine shook her head. There's nothing to rehearse. We all feel that you'd be perfect looking after our investments. I was really shocked when Wakefield Hamilton let you go, because the word was you were one of the best accountants they'd ever hired. Nydia made a sucking sound with her tongue and teeth. I was one of the newbies, so that meant I was expendable. Don't even go there, Jasmine drawled, frowning. You were 10 times brighter than that idiot who headed your unit. And there were rumors that you completed his monthly reports. I'd occasionally sit in on the department head meetings, and when it came time for Hank to give his report, he babbled like someone under the influence. That's because he was taking meclizine for vertigo. He told me this in confidence, so I never mentioned it to anyone, Nydia said in defense of her former supervisor. Tanya took a sip of water. So you covered his ass? It wasn't so much covering. What else was it, Nydia? Jasmine questioned. You did the man's job, and you'd think he would have recommended you for a promotion. Her mouth twisted in derision. I saw more underhanded crap I didn't need to see working in HR. Hannah emitted an unladylike snort. It was the same in the legal department, and it wasn't until we were standing on the sidewalk with our banker boxes that I realized that more than half the downsized were female. Not only do we make less than our male counterparts for the same work, but when it comes to handing out pink slips, we're the first to be shown the door. Now talking about promotions, Jasmine, you should have been the one to head HR after Brian Harvey left. Instead, they brought in that pimply-faced boy who didn't know his ass from his elbow to replace him. Jasmine raised her goblet of sparkling water. I agree, but that's because they didn't want me privy to the merger and who they'd planned to lay off. Would you have let it slip about the layoffs? Nydia asked Jasmine. No. Even if my name was on the list, I wouldn't have said a word to anyone. That's because you're ethical, Hannah stated. Tanya ran a finger down the stem of her wine glass. I don't know about the rest of y'all, but Wakefield Hamilton did me a favor letting me go. If they hadn't let you go, would you have commuted to New Jersey? Hannah asked. I doubt it. I'd have to be on the train at 4 a.m. to make it down to Trenton in time to set up the kitchen for a breakfast meeting. Everything worked out for you, Nydia said, because you'll open up your own restaurant with your poppy. Everyone laughed at her description of Gage. Suddenly, she sobered. I don't know about the other employees, but it appears as if being downsized has worked well for you guys. Three pairs of eyes were fixed on Nydia as a swollen silence followed her statement. What's the matter? Why aren't you going to include yourself in that equation? Tanya questioned. And please don't tell me you're still messing with that bum who's looking for his big break. Nydia's eyes burned with amber fire as she struggled to control her rising temper. Why can't you believe me when I say I'm through with Danny? Jasmine met her eyes. He may be through with him, but I'm willing to bet that he's not through with you. Nydia glared at Jasmine. She regretted telling her about Danny seeking out her parents to ask about her whereabouts after she'd sublet Tanya's apartment. It doesn't matter, because I'd given him too many chances to get his act together. And even if he did secure a record deal, I still wouldn't go back with him. I've learned a lot of things about myself since I'm no longer involved with Danny. I may have been in love with him, but I never allowed my heart to overrule my head. And more importantly, I'm at a stage in my life where I believe I don't need a man to complete me. How old are you now? Hannah asked. 33? Don't you want to marry and have kids? Nydia's eyebrows lifted slightly. I still have a few years before my biological clock starts winding down. Just don't wait as long as I did, Jasmine hinted with a broad grin. Tanya turned to look at Jasmine. Didn't you tell me you and Cameron didn't plan for this baby? Jasmine nodded. We even used a condom. Daddy must have nuclear-powered sperm to penetrate latex, Nydia stated deadpan. Pinpoints of color dotted Jasmine's gold-brown complexion at the same time Hannah and Tanya burst into laughter. Seconds later, Nydia joined them. She was laughing so hard at Jasmine's shocked expression that her side hurt. She pointed to Hannah. Don't laugh, Hannah, because you may be the next one to announce that she's in the family way. Hannah blotted the tears running down her cheeks. That's not going to happen, because I'm finished with menopause, and St. John had a vasectomy when he was still married to his first wife. She exhaled an audible breath. Remember when I told you that St. John had admitted to cheating on his wife? Yes. What happened? Tanya asked. Nydia's shocked expression mirrored Jasmine and Tanya's, her mouth gaping, as she intently listened to Hannah explain that St. John's first wife had been sexually abused as a child by her uncle, who'd gotten her pregnant. She hadn't told her aunt that her uncle was the father of her unborn child, because he'd threatened to kill her if she revealed their secret liaisons. Her aunt arranged for her to undergo an abortion, and the trauma had scarred her for life, so she would not permit her husband to make love to her. Tanya's eyes were brimming with unshed tears.
How long were they married?
Hannah bit down on her lip. More than 30 years. She ignored the gasps coming from the others in the room. It wasn't until Lorna filed for divorce that she was able to tell St. John about her uncle's abuse. She claimed she was afraid to say anything because she feared what St. John would do to him. Jasmine shook her head. So instead of trusting her husband to protect her from the pedophile, she denied him her body for 3 decades, which forced him to become an adulterer.
That's a damn shame, Tanya whispered. If I found out that some man had abused my daughter, I would have sharpened one of my chef knives, cut off his dick, and then cauterized it with a fire starter to see how long he could piss out of a nub.
Whoa! Damn! No, you didn't say that.
Jasmine, Hannah, and Nydia had all spoken at the same time.
"Why are y'all looking at me like that?"
Tanya asked. "I only said what you'd be thinking if you had a daughter." The mood lifted when Nydia mentioned Tanya's daughter's surprise engagement. Samara had come to her mother's wedding with her fiancé and wearing a diamond engagement ring. The recent Spelman College graduate had not told her mother that she'd been dating a student from Morehouse School of Medicine, who'd also graduated that spring. Samara, who was pursuing graduate studies, had recently moved into her fiancé's parents' guest house until she could rent an apartment. 90 minutes after they sat down to eat, while baring their souls, the four women took turns hugging one another. Nydia felt as if time and distance did little to affect the closeness she'd developed with her former co-workers. She'd thought it ironic during the 4 years she'd been employed at Wakefield Hamilton, they'd only gotten together during the bank's sanctioned holiday celebrations. And now fast forward 15 months, and they'd formed a sisterhood that she was certain would impact the rest of their lives. Jasmine joined Nydia as she took the elevator to her floor. Jasmine had promised to show her the converted warehouse where she would live with Cameron once the renovations were completed, before they visited a local bridal salon to select gowns for the wedding. The elevator arrived at the fourth floor, and they shared a smile. "Thanks again for getting everyone together to welcome me back." Jasmine quickly smothered a yawn behind her hand. "There's no need to thank me. It felt good to get the gang back together." "I'll meet you in the lobby at 10. She stepped out of the car with Nydia. "I'm going to take another elevator that stops at the fifth floor." "Luego, mija." Jasmine wiggled her fingers. "Buenas noches, chica." Nydia walked to her suite. A wave of fatigue washed over her as soon as she opened the door, despite having taken a nap earlier that afternoon. She usually sat up watching late-night TV. But tonight wouldn't be one of those times. She cleansed her face of the light cover of makeup, brushed her teeth, and then secured her shoulder-length hair in a single braid. She slipped into a cotton nightgown, and within minutes of getting into bed, she fell asleep. Chapter 3. Lamar Pierce checked his watch when he heard the sound of an approaching vehicle. He smiled. She was on time. His client's fiance had called the day before to ask whether he'd be available to show her the new construction to the rear of the property she wanted as a loggia for alfresco dining, and he'd quickly rearranged his schedule to accommodate her. When Cameron Singleton introduced Jasmine Washington as an interior decorator and his fiancé, Lamar hadn't been able to conceal his surprise. It was the latter that had taken him aback, because he was well aware of Cameron's reputation as an eligible bachelor. Subsequent to their meeting, Cameron had contacted him and asked him to save the date for his wedding and not share the news with anyone because he wanted it to be a surprise. Lamar wanted to tell him it would be more than a surprise to those in the Big Easy. It was certain to shock those who hadn't expected the wealthy, very eligible certified financial planner to marry, and definitely not to a woman of color, because Cameron's taste in women tended to extend to blondes and redheads. He walked over to the gleaming, late-model pearl-white Honda Odyssey, parked along the curb behind the construction crews, vans, and pickups. Lamar opened the driver's side door, extended his hand, and assisted Jasmine out of the vehicle. She looked nothing like the woman he'd met for the first time in the private dining room of the Louis LaSalle Hotel. Then, she'd appeared very businesslike in a pantsuit, with her hair styled in a twist off the nape of her neck. He'd commissioned the interior decorator for a personal project and was astounded by her artistic flair and attention to detail. Today she wore a loose-fitting floral print top with a pair of navy leggings and matching peep-toe booties. A loose ponytail had replaced the chic twist. Lamar extended his hand. "Good morning." Jasmine smiled and took his hand. Good morning. Thank you for making time for me.
It's...
His words trailed off when he saw the petite woman with a wealth of dark curls floating around her shoulders emerge from the passenger seat of the minivan. His eyes met a pair of hazel ones that were almost an exact match to his. Lamar's mother had drilled into him that it was impolite to stare at someone. But at that moment, he completely forgot his home training. If he was staring, then she was also. Lamar didn't know why, but she reminded him of the illustrations of fairy tale princesses in the books he read to his daughter. Lamar, I asked to meet you because I wanted to show Nydia the property before it's completely renovated. Nydia, this is Lamar Pierce. He's project engineer responsible for turning this place into a showplace. Lamar, Nydia Santiago. Nydia offered Lamar her hand. It's nice meeting you. Jasmine's introduction shattered his silent entrancement with the woman with delicate features and a flawless taupe complexion. He grasped the small hand, which disappeared into his larger one.
My pleasure, Miss Santiago.
She smiled. Please call me Nydia. His eyebrows flickered slightly.
And I'm Lamar.
It took Herculean strength for Lamar to pull his eyes away from this slender woman with eyes that reminded him of semi-precious gems and a generous mouth that probably had men fantasizing about kissing her. As soon as the notion entered his head, he chided himself for entertaining licentious thoughts about a woman whom he knew nothing about except her name.
Please wait here, he said. I'm going to get some hard hats from my truck.
Lamar knew he had to put some distance between him and Nydia, if only to deal with his unexpected reaction to her. It had been more than 10 years since a woman had enthralled him within seconds of his meeting her, and that woman was one he'd eventually married. Nydia exchanged a look with Jasmine as Lamar walked down the block and opened the door to a black pickup.
We have the same color eyes.
Jasmine nodded. That's what I thought when I first met him. However, yours have more green, while his have glints of gold.
Something about him bothers me.
How, chica? Jasmine asked. Although I'm flattered by his staring, he also made me feel uncomfortable. A hint of a smile touched the corners of Jasmine's mouth. That's because he likes what he sees. A frown settled into Nydia's features.
Aw, hell no, mija. What he likes and what he gets are entirely two different things. Did you not see the band on his left hand? The man's married, and I'm not one to entertain another woman's husband. My mantra is, if I can't be the entree, then I'm not going to be the appetizer or the dessert. At least when Cameron couldn't take his eyes off you, some woman didn't have papers on him.
I think you're being a little too hasty and...
Hasty? Nydia said, cutting her off. Please, Jazz, I don't want to talk about Lamar Pierce.
Once Nydia ended her relationship with her ex, she had purposefully put up a shield to keep all men at a distance, and had given herself a year of not dating anyone to assess what she wanted for her future. A beat passed before Jasmine said,
Okay.
Nydia exhaled an audible sigh of relief as she glanced up at the building, set behind a massive wrought iron door.
This place is huge.
It used to be a warehouse where bales of raw cotton were stored before they were loaded onto ships and transported to New England or European cotton mills.
Why did Cameron decide to buy a warehouse?
He said although he finds it convenient living in a hotel. He claims he wanted a place where he could entertain clients, friends, and family without reserving a room at the LaSalle.
I haven't seen the inside, but I'm willing to bet it's as large as the DuPont Inn.
Jasmine nodded.
It's about the same. Coño, mija. I can't believe it's only going to be you, Cameron, and that little muffin cooking inside you living in this mansion. After you have your baby, you need to wait for your 6-week checkup and start working on another one. A house this big needs the patter of a lot of little feet.
That's not happening, Nydia. If Cameron and I decide to have more children, then we'll adopt. And speaking of babies, I'd be honored if you'd be godmother to this one.
Nydia stared wide-eyed, unblinking.
Are you sure?
Of course I'm sure. I wouldn't be asking if I wasn't sure.
Unexpected tears filled Nydia's eyes, and she was suddenly overcome with a swell of emotion. She'd wanted to be godmother to one of her nieces, but when it didn't happen, she dismissed it as her sister-in-law's choice to make.
Thank you, Jasmine. I'm really honored you asked me.
No more talk about the baby, Jasmine said sotto voce. Lamar's coming back.
Nydia reached into her crossbody purse for a tissue and touched it to the corners of her eyes. She rarely exhibited public displays of emotion, but Jasmine asking her to become godmother to her son or daughter was an honor she would cherish forever. If only a few people knew about Cameron marrying Jasmine, even fewer knew that he was going to be a father. Lamar handed each a bright yellow hard hat. Please put these on and watch where you step once we're inside. Nydia ignored Lamar's furtive glance as she put on the hat. She had to concede he was extremely attractive, but she found his features rather delicate for a man. She estimated he was at least 40 or close to it, despite his close-cropped, prematurely gray hair, which was a striking contrast to his unlined sable-brown complexion. High cheekbones and a hint of the cleft in his strong chin all made for an arresting face. He was casually dressed in a pair of khakis, a navy blue golf shirt, and tan work boots. Lamar put on his own hard hat and unlocked the wrought iron door leading to a cobblestone walkway that opened out into an expansive courtyard. Several dumpsters and construction equipment took up two corners of the open space that was an emerald jungle with trees, flowing shrubs, and ferns growing in abandon. There was also an enormous fountain in the middle of the enclosure, with a marble cherub holding a pitcher from which water would flow if operable.
Can you imagine holding a cookout here?
Nydia whispered to Jasmine, unaware that Lamar had overheard her.
I thought St. John's backyard was big, but this is incredible.
Jasmine nodded. If the house had been completely renovated, I would have convinced Cameron to have the ceremony and reception here.
I saw the video from Tanya's wedding, and the courtyard where they exchanged vows made it look like a fairy tale wedding.
I'm sorry you missed it.
Nydia hadn't experienced a lot of disappointment in her life, but not being able to attend Tanya's wedding was one. She'd been confined to a hospital bed with pain and antibiotic fluids running through an IV and into her body while her friend was marrying a man with whom she'd been given a second chance at love. Nydia knew, even if she hadn't delayed seeking medical attention, with the onset of pain in her side, she still wouldn't have been cleared to travel in time to attend Tanya and Gage's nuptials. However, she was given the opportunity to attend another wedding 2 months later as Jasmine married Cameron. She wasn't able to conceal a gasp of astonishment when Lamar opened another oak door to an enormous street-level space with stone floors and brick walls. The sounds of hammering, sawing, and drilling could be heard over the distinctive voice of Michael Jackson's Billie Jean.
Watch your step, Lamar cautioned as he led the way to the rear of the property.
Several men nodded to him before going back to concentrate on their tasks. Nydia pulled her eyes away from a trio of staircases leading to the upper stories. She carefully wended her way through sawhorses, wheelbarrows, stacks of bricks, cinder blocks, coils of wire, and copper piping. When Jasmine had informed her that Cameron had bought a house, she thought it would be similar to the ones featured in the French Quarter, with shuttered windows and decorative wrought iron balconies, and not one where intercoms were essential in order to communicate with one another. Nydia and Jasmine expelled audible gasps at the same time when they stepped out onto the loggia with the cross-beamed ceiling supported by brick columns and terracotta flooring. It was the perfect place to begin and end the day.
I hope it meets your specifications,
Lamar said to Jasmine. Her smile mirrored approval. It's perfect and beyond my expectations. She pressed her palms together. Thank you again for taking the time to show me what you've done with the loggia.
I hope to see you again at my wedding. Lamar smiled, the expression making him appear rather boyish despite the gray hair.
Of course, I wouldn't miss it.
By the way, Nydia's going to be my maid of honor. Lamar angled his head as he gave Nydia a direct stare.
I hope you'll save a dance for me.
Nydia narrowed her eyes. I will, but only if Mrs. Pierce doesn't mind you dancing with me. Throwing back his head, Lamar laughed loudly.
The only Mrs. Pierce I know is 65 and lives in Baton Rouge with my sister and her grandchildren.
Nydia's eyelids fluttered, her breath quickened, and her cheeks became warm from embarrassment. She was angry with herself for assuming Lamar was married.
Well, damn it, she thought. He is wearing a wedding band.
She curbed the urge to stick out her tongue at him. It was something she'd done as a child when she felt the need to punish someone.
Yes, I will save you a dance.
Lamar's smile was still in place when he inclined his head.
Thank you.
Nydia looped her arm through Jasmine's as they turned to retrace their steps.
I'm going to get you for that, she said under her breath, speaking Spanish. Why didn't you tell me the man's not married?
I tried to tell you, Jasmine replied in the same language, but you cut me off saying you'll never be a married man's appetizer or dessert. But the main dish.
He's a widower, she added.
Nydia rolled her eyes.
Why the heck is he still wearing a wedding ring? She continued in Spanish.
Jasmine smiled. You can ask him that when you dance with him at my wedding.
No entraré en el negocio personal del hombre.
Nydia had no intention of getting into the man's personal business. She would dance with him and leave it at that. It did not matter if she did find Lamar attractive. He would become an acquaintance and nothing more. Her friends and family members had told her repeatedly to stop dating Danny, and there were occasions when she had. However, that was short-lived. Whenever he called begging that he loved and missed her, it had all come to an end when she moved out of her landlady's house, leaving no forwarding address and blocking Danny's number. That day in November, she'd made herself a solemn promise not to date anyone for a year. And she'd come to learn a lot about herself over the past 9 months. Not only hadn't she needed a man to complete her, but she also liked her own company. She'd invite her cousins and a few friends she'd grown up with in her old neighborhood over to the apartment, where they'd spent hours eating, drinking, laughing, and talking about what was happening in their lives. The get-togethers reminded Nydia of the camaraderie she'd shared with Tanya, Hannah, Samara, and Jasmine when they'd set out on their road trip from New York City to New Orleans. And she continued to marvel at how quickly she'd bonded with her coworkers. And what she had to decide before the end of October was whether to renew the lease or give notice that she was vacating the apartment before January 31st.
I like this swagger wagon,
Nydia said as Jasmine maneuvered the minivan into an empty space at the rear of the bridal salon. Jasmine laughed. I'm beginning to like it, too. The automatic sliding doors make it hands-free for loading and unloading.
Do you miss your Denali?
Not really.
Why didn't you call your ex and ask him if he's willing to buy it from you?
Nydia teased. Jasmine shook her head. You know you're wrong, chica.
No, I'm not. Because you know damn well your leech ex-husband was ready to fight you tooth and nail for that vehicle so we could ride that woman and her tribe of kids around in it.
Well, he'll never get it because I transferred the title to my cousin.
Isn't it funny that aside from a larger share of your design business, the two other things he wanted most your cousin has, the condo and the Denali?
Jasmine went completely still as she stared out the windshield.
When you say you're so over Danny, it's the same with me, Nydia. In less than 2 weeks, I'm going to marry a man I never believed I could love. And hopefully before the end of the year, we'll move into our new home and then ring in the new year with a child I never thought I'd have.
Unbuckling her seatbelt, Nydia leaned over and hugged her friend.
You deserve everything coming to you and some.
Jasmine held on to Nydia's forearm.
What about you, chica? Don't you think it's time for you to have a happily ever after? What makes you think I'm not happy? I don't have ex-husbands or children like you, Hannah or Tanya, but that doesn't mean my life is fraught with angst or filled with bad memories.
Danny was my first real serious boyfriend, but at no time did I ever allow my heart to overrule my head.
What attracted you to him?
Nydia extricated her arm from Jasmine's and pressed her head to the headrest. His positive attributes are, he's extremely talented, and he didn't cheat on me. But it was his refusal to become gainfully employed that was a continual source of contention between us. He earned just enough working as a part-time waiter and singing with a Latin band on weekends to pay for studio time. I got tired of telling him that all the men in my family worked and supported their families, and I expected the same from him. Even if I had greater earning power, I wouldn't have held that over his head.
Jasmine patted Nydia's hand. Don't beat yourself up, chica. You gave him more chances than he deserved.
You got that right. Now, before we go in, do you have any idea of what type of gown you want?
I told the owner I wanted a gown with an empire waist because it would de-emphasize my waistline.
You're not showing.
I'm getting thick in the waist.
Let's go, mija. We need to pick out a gown for you and one for me, along with all of the accessories.
Nydia settled down on the love seat, picked up the remote device, and flicked on the wall-mounted flat screen. She blew out an audible sigh. It felt good to just sit and relax. Jasmine had extended an invitation for Nydia to join her and Cameron in their suite for the evening meal, but she'd declined and ordered room service. Earlier that morning, it had taken her and Jasmine almost 3 hours to pick out their gowns. The salon owner and her staff were patient and gracious, offering them water, juice, and freshly prepared fruit and green salads for a light snack during a break. Unlike Jasmine, who knew exactly what style and color she wanted, it wasn't the same for Nydia, who'd always found herself in a quandary when it came to choosing between more than one garment. It wasn't until she'd resorted to the nursery rhyme, Eeny, Meeny, Miny, Moe, that she'd finally selected her bridesmaid gown. Fittings followed, and the seamstress set a date for them to return several days before the wedding for a final fitting. Nydia turned the television to a popular entertainment channel and became suddenly alert when she heard the correspondent mention her ex-boyfriend's name. More than 2 million hits on Danny Ocasio's YouTube video had landed him a record deal with a major recording company. A publicist from the company had predicted Danny was certain to become a Latin crossover artist with the sensuality of Enrique Iglesias and a voice comparable to Mark Anthony's. Nydia's cell phone chimed a familiar ringtone. She picked up the phone after the second ring.
I just saw it, Millie, she said to her cousin.
Milagros Baez's distinctive laugh came through the mouthpiece.
Can you believe it? He finally made it.
Good for him. I know you had your ups and downs with Danny, but you don't sound excited that he's going to be a big star.
Nydia closed her eyes. What did her cousin expect her to say?
Danny had worked hard to get a recording contract, even if it meant forfeiting a relationship with her.
I'm happy for him, Millie. He deserves every good thing coming his way.
Danny called me a couple of days ago to let me know the segment was airing tonight, Milagros continued. He said he wanted to personally share his good news with you, but you'd blocked his number.
A beat passed. He wanted me to tell you that he still loves you and would like to see you in person. Of course, I didn't tell him where you were, but said I would pass along the message.
You can tell him I'm out of town and I'll contact him once I return to New York after Labor Day weekend.
Nydia didn't tell Millie that she had no intention of reviving her relationship with Danny because emotionally she had moved on.
I'll let him know. How are you feeling, prima? Milagros asked.
I'm real good.
A slight twinge on her right side was a reminder of her recent surgical procedure, and Nydia realized it would take time before she healed completely. She muted the television and listened to her cousin, who updated her about the latest love of her life. Nydia smiled as Millie rambled on about the too-good-to-be-true man she'd met on a dating site. She was happy for the woman who'd had her share of heartbreak. 10 minutes after answering the call, Nydia hung up. She'd planned to stay up and watch a movie, but changed her mind. After turning off the television, she adjusted the thermostat and then walked into the bathroom to shower and brush her teeth. The glowing numbers on the bedside clock displayed 8:01. I've become my abuela, she thought. Nydia's 85-year-old grandmother had established a routine of going to bed at 8 o'clock every night to get what she called her beauty sleep. She had to acknowledge her abuelita, who never smoked, rarely drank, except for a glass of coquito during Christmas, could easily pass for a woman at least 10 years younger. Nydia knew the heat and humidity were responsible for her lethargy, and it would take at least a week to acclimate her body to the tropical-like weather. Chapter 4 Nydia helped Jasmine as she stepped into her wedding gown. For the past 2 weeks, she'd felt like a hamster on a wheel, running around in endless circles, and since arriving in New Orleans, one day had blurred into the next one. She had tried on several gowns in varying shades of yellow before selecting a sunny yellow, one-shoulder chiffon gown, nipped at the waist and flowing around her feet like frothy meringue. Strappy matching satin and patent leather platform sandals added 4 inches to her 5'2" height. And as promised, Tanya prepared and delivered a 2-week supply of frozen dinner entrees. It had
become a... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.